Good morning. Welcome to First United Church of Christ. I hope a lot of you got to go out and enjoy the weather yesterday. It's absolutely gorgeous. Definitely one of those days that I treasure, and hopefully we have some more coming up. Sun's out, cheers our mood during this dark time, during this mysterious time, and it just really just brings us hope and joy. Speaking of hope and joy, some announcements this morning. For Holy Week, our Holy Week schedule is going to be in your bulletin, and it's also in the upcoming newsletter. We also have two Easter services this year. We sent out a survey to kind of gather who all would be coming to Easter and how many they anticipate bringing with them. And the numbers were high enough for us to say, well, maybe it would be prudent to have two Easter services. And what we're going to do to try to make it just a delight for each service is the 8 a.m. service is going to be outside, weather permitting, and it's going to be in the courtyard, and hopefully, you know, the sun will be shining on that day. But if there's any rain conditions, or if we look at the forecast and there's rain conditions, then we'll be moving into the fellowship hall and to utilize the new stage. But this way, especially with sunrise, it kind of taps into some of our old traditions of an Easter sunrise service or an outdoor Easter service, and we're able to enjoy that together. The 8 a.m. service and the 9:15 a.m. service will be identical in content except for music. So the music in here will be the beautiful Easter music that we've been accustomed to. And then the music in the courtyard will be primarily just me leading on guitar, but also doing some of the more classic hymns that people love and cherish as well, since I love hymns, so that's what I'm going to do. But we just invite you to either one of those. There will be communion offered at both services, and we think that offering it this way would keep everyone as safe as possible while also giving us the opportunity to celebrate the joy that is the resurrection of our Lord. For other announcements this morning, soup suppers are still going on. Soup suppers and Zoom Bible studies. We're studying the Shema, which is an ancient prayer in the Old Testament. If you haven't Zoomed in to those studies, you might want to. You might want to see what it's all about. You might want to join in the discussion. We watch a five to six minute animated video clip. We watch that, and it's very informative, and then we just spend time talking. So the lesson starts at 7:45 and ends at 8:45, and the Zoom room opens up at 7:30. So if you're interested in that and you haven't come before, come on out, try it out. It'll be in the email announcements, or you can contact the church office if you don't receive that. We also have One Great Hour of Sharing, which is our annual fundraising event. So that's being raised right now. There's little M&M containers in the back in a basket, and you take an M&M container, you eat the delicious delicacies, and then you fill the M&M container back up with quarters, and you bring that in, and that helps us raise money. And more information for that is in the bulletin. We also wanted to extend our sympathy to the Minerick family who lost Perry, and he died on Wednesday, March 10th, and services were private at the request of the family. So please keep his wife Sue in your prayers and their family. And also please pray for Marilyn Moll and her family at the passing of Marilyn's brother-in-law, Bernie Kranica, who passed away on March 15th. And also keep Sharon Roberts in your prayers. Her father also passed away. And just as we take this time to pray as a faith community, it's a time to lift one another up and share one another's burdens. And let us do that. And as And let us be reminded of that as we continue on in our worship service with the calling bell. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. And now we will be blessed with some special music from Ginny Arana and Ed Swartz. It's one of my favorite songs growing up, so it's always good to hear it again. Except that was in our contemporary book at church. Now we come to our time of confession, which is a time in our faith community which we join saints throughout the centuries recognizing that we are in need of a Savior. So let us confess, and you can just pray this along with me silently. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. And now, if we have confessed together, and that if we have been sincere and honest in heart, we are assured by the grace of our Lord that we are forgiven, that we are washed clean, and that we are continually loved in our good times and in our times where we wish we could have done more or wish we didn't do something else. We are forgiven and we are loved. And now for our first scripture lesson, that comes from Hebrews chapter 5, verses 5 to 10 in the New Living Translation. That is why Christ did not honor himself by assuming he could become high priest. No, he was chosen by God, who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And in another passage, God said to him, "You are a priest forever, in the order of Melchizedek." While Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleadings with a loud cry and tears to the one who could rescue him from death. And God heard his prayers because of his deep reverence for God. Even though Jesus was God's son, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. In this way, God qualified him as a perfect high priest, and he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. And God designated him to be a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. This ends the first scripture reading.
The second scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, beginning with the 20th verse. Some Greeks who had come to Jerusalem for the Passover celebration paid a visit to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee. They said, "Sir, we want to meet Jesus." Philip told Andrew about it, and they went together to ask Jesus. Jesus replied, "Now the time has come for the Son of Man to enter into his glory. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat is planted in the soil and dies, it remains alone. But its death will produce many new kernels, a plentiful harvest of new lives. Those who love their life in this world will lose it. Those who care nothing for their life in this world will keep it for eternity. Anyone who wants to serve me must follow me, because my servants must be where I am, and the Father will honor anyone who serves me. Now my soul is deeply troubled. Should I pray, 'Father, save me from this hour?' But this is the very reason I came. 'Father, bring glory to your name.' Then a voice from heaven saying, 'I have already brought glory to my name, and I will do it again.' When the crowd heard the voice, some thought it was thunder, and others declared an angel had spoken to him. Then Jesus told them, 'The voice was for your benefit, not mine. The time for judging this world has come, when Satan, the ruler of this world, will be cast out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself.' He said this to indicate how he was going to die." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We have been looking week to week in the current sermon series at ways that God is active, ways that God is active in different situations that we face. And this week, it's a fairly difficult one because we're going to look at ways that God is active when we're in trouble of some sort, when we're under stress. Let me approach this with some current events. I looked it up. The Johns Hopkins University coronavirus tracking site says that last Tuesday, 740 people died in this country because of the coronavirus. This is down. The high was back in January 12th when 4,470 people died. So there's a sense this is good news. It's only 1/6 as many dying now as had been earlier. Maybe the season, the vaccines, this social distancing, the things we're doing are working. But on the other hand, it's tragic news. 740 families have lost someone that they loved because of this disease. Within our own congregation, just the week before, the Miller family lost Ray. Carolina Simon has lost two aunts in Brazil. And she has an uncle who is, we hope, recovering now, but also who has this virus. We are still finding in our own congregation people are contracting this disease. So the pandemic has caused millions of deaths. It's still killing. And I'm certain that people in every one of those families who have lost someone are at some level asking themselves, where is God in this? Where is God? Well, in the Old Testament, there was a direct answer. Plagues happened because God sent them. God sent plagues to punish people for being proud, for being disobedient, for being bad. And not just plagues, droughts, invasion, came because people deserved them. And the only way to avoid or stop these events, these catastrophes, was to be humble, to be obedient and good, and return to obedience to God. Now we hear this in our call to worship, because this is the 51st Psalm that David wrote. It is attributed to him after he got Bathsheba pregnant and then had her husband killed, so he could quickly marry her and legitimize the baby. Now, when the child was born, it became deathly ill. And David saw this as punishment from God, and that's writing this psalm. Maybe if he could acknowledge, maybe God would relent and the baby would live. Just remember verse 8 that we read. This is a little different translation, but the words are very close. David says, "Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. Let me now rejoice." David pleads that he has heard God, he has repented, he knows he is wrong, he should never have done what he did. And in his humility, will God now save his child? Well, the child dies. And David afterward goes to the temple and worships in sorrow. So that was in the Old Testament, but I think that all of us, including me, have some Old Testament David within us. When we run into trouble, we wonder if God is some way behind it, if our sins in some way have caused it or added to it. And we think, oh, what did we do wrong? What can we do to make this right? But this is not how God works according to the New Testament, according to what Jesus did to maybe mid-course correct or made what Jesus had us to do to understand God. Now, the first scripture reading was from the book of Hebrews. Now, that one is named so because it just beautifully connects the prophecy, the law, the traditions of Hebrews with what Jesus said and did. In fact, if you remember, there was reference in it to the analogy of a high priest. That's something that was very meaningful to Hebrews, not so to most other people. The author of Hebrews is not known. The book stands on its content, and people have been speculating who wrote it, but it stands on its own. It is not in the Bible because of the fame or what people know about the author. Now, interestingly, this is a little side trip, but interestingly, the most convincing theory I have read about the author of Hebrews, and it is exhaustively defended, convinces me, is that Hebrews was written by a well-educated Roman woman named Priscilla. And Priscilla is mentioned often by Paul as a co-worker and someone who helped him on his journey. In verse 5, she writes this about Jesus. He was chosen by God, who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." In other words, while Jesus was living on earth, his instructions were to relate to God as a good son relates to a good father. And we still use the father designation oftentimes these days. But I'm not trying to give gender here. But I will say something about this parent analogy that I think can get us into a little trouble. Human parents, certainly I did, I think those of you who are parents did also, at times used punishment in instilling knowledge or good behavior in our children. This is because children, usually, before they learn to do the right thing just because they want to do it and it's right and they want to be good, they do things because they'll get into trouble with dad or mom if they don't. It's natural then for us humans, to associate trouble, being in trouble, with something we did wrong, with being punished for misbehavior. It's just a logical connection for us. It's an expectation of cause and effect. If I'm in trouble, I must have done something. But this analogy, this way of looking at how God treats us, is what Jesus dismissed. No, not so. Put away. Stop it. Forget it. This is what Jesus dismissed as the wisdom of this world. It's logical. We're in trouble. Something must have caused it. But attributing it to God is wrong. In fact, punishing us in this life is the opposite of what Jesus revealed about God's purpose, God's activity, what God intended, and why he was here. We have to put aside, hopefully make this more comfortable, we have to put aside this idea that we're getting punished, that God is punishing us. That's not what God is doing when we're in trouble. Well, if not punishment, then what is God doing? There's another thought that comes up. I've thought it, wondered. And that is the thought that, well, God is abandoning us. God may not be doing the punishing, but God is not protecting us from Satan, from our own dumbness, from whatever the situation is. God is standing back and just letting us experience either what we deserve or what some other force is causing us to feel. We're left on our own. Again, this is wisdom of this world. It is not the wisdom of God. Now, I will grant that for a brief time on the cross, Jesus felt a moment of abandonment by God. You know, my Lord, where are you? But there is no other example in Jesus' teachings. I don't think there's any other example in the New Testament where the problem that people are experiencing is because God has turned away. God has lost interest. God has given up. God has gotten frustrated with us and so is withholding who God is. It's just not there. We are not abandoned any more than we are punished. So, if God isn't punishing us and isn't abandoning us, what is God doing? Because we are suffering trouble. Well, there's going a little further on what we read in Hebrews. Here's maybe something to think about. I'm going to read verse 8. Even though Jesus was God's son, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. In this way, God qualified him as a perfect high priest, and he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. So when Jesus was confronting that he was going to be arrested and crucified, his thought was, is this really what you want me to do? Can you take this away from me, Lord? God, Father, can you take this away from me? And the answer was, wait, that's why I'm here. There are other things going on here. There is a bigger picture. There is more going on than just my suffering that I'm experiencing now. In Jesus' case, he was taking the sins of mankind on himself. He was setting the example that faith is worth life. There may be a larger purpose at work. There was for Jesus. Is there for us? Now, the idea that, well, when we're in trouble, we're suffering, there's really something else going on in the background, and we should, you know, just go through it because something good will come out of it. I think there's a division there between the kind of trouble that we're experiencing. If we're in the middle, if we've done some things wrong that we shouldn't do, then and we get caught, I think it's probably this argument that, well, maybe there's a bigger purpose over the long run is a good thing to think about. But if the trouble we're in is losing a loved one to COVID, the idea that, well, maybe something good will come out of it in the future, maybe there's a bigger purpose, it just is, it's not comforting, and it really doesn't fit, I don't think, with God's compassion for people. We don't get sick and die so that, by and large, so that something else can happen. But it's repeated often enough that there is a larger purpose behind this life that I'm going to just say a little more about it. In our second reading from John, Gospel of John, John is quoting Jesus' words just before his arrest and crucifixion. And Jesus says, "Now my soul is deeply troubled. Should I pray, Father, save me from this hour? But this is the very reason I came," just as I said earlier. "So, Father, bring glory to your name." Jesus saw the larger purpose. And here's another one. Book of James, first chapter, verse 2. "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy." Consider troubles an opportunity for joy. "For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing." Now, the idea is, okay, we go through suffering, and part of it is to come out of it better people than we started. And I think that's always true. In every situation, God would like us to be a better person. But we, I think, have to divide trouble, as I said. And now we're going to look at trouble due to losing someone that we loved and now have lost. And learning endurance, maybe you do some, that is not how God is present teaching us endurance. That is not God's goal, God's activity, when we are grieving the loss of someone we love. I'd like to take a look at 2 Corinthians, first chapter, verses 3-5. "All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort." The source of all comfort. This is how God is present for us in grief. Now, comfort. It's awfully hard to accept to get a hold of comfort when we are in a time of grief, because our sense of loss overwhelms us. Grief counselors, they all agree that grief just takes time. You can't speed it up. You have to go through the stages. And I'm going to say, I think that grieving is part of being made in God's image. Grieving is partly a human factor of being made in God's image. Jesus grieved when John the Baptist was beheaded. Jesus' disciples grieved when Jesus was crucified. Now, in the disciples' case, they got a reprieve that we don't. Jesus actually came back and appeared to them, and he talked about him being gone. But what he said, he did not say, "Oh, stop grieving. I want you to jump around and smile." What what Jesus said to them is, I will be with you, and I will send you a comforter, the Holy Spirit. Jesus' message to his grieving disciples was, you need to be comforted, and I am going to send you the Holy Spirit to comfort you. And he did. Paul goes on in this 2 Corinthians chapter, and he says, God comforts us in our troubles so we can comfort others when they are troubled. And so forth, we will all be able to give them the same kind of comfort that God has given us. So in one way, we may come out of a time of grieving better people, because now, having experienced it, we may be able to help others who are in grief. But that's not the primary thing that's going on with God being active when we are in trouble. Not if the trouble is actual loss and grieving. Here's how God is really with us in the face of COVID. God is loving us. And God's, in his love, is offering comfort. It's not punishment, it's not abandonment, it's far more than teaching us endurance. It's loving us, understanding and having compassion for us, hearing us, offering us comfort on every level. God loves us by letting us be sorrowful, letting us be angry, letting us be afraid, letting us cry out in pain, and letting us grieve for as long as it takes. God says, okay. When we are able, God is there. God is soothing our emotions through the Holy Spirit. God is loving us by addressing our fear of the worst by saying, there is another life coming that is the best for the person lost and for you who are grieving. God loves us by softening our feelings, feelings of abandonment. And now we come back to the second verse that I read in Corinthians. God softens our feelings of abandonment and isolation and being alone and loss by sending love and companionship and compassion through others. That's our job. That is our job. When one is grieving, others come and enfold. So when we suffer loss, this is what God is doing. This is how God is present for us. God is open, is offering hope, compassion, and some caring people to bring us comfort and healing. And he's asking us, when we are through our grief, to now go out and multiply his comfort by going to others who are grieving, as with COVID. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God of love, thank you for caring for us under all circumstances, even the worst. Thank you for never sending us trouble as punishment. Thank you for never abandoning us. Thank you for teaching us through adversity. thank you for your love and understanding and hope and comfort when we most need it. Help us carry the gift of your presence and your comfort to others. We love you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Kelly and Marc for this beautiful rendition of By My Side. We were not able to show the video that came along with this morning, but if you go to the video this afternoon when it's uploaded, the video will be included, so that's a reason to go take a look. What a beautiful rendition. Thank you again, Kelly and Marc. And now for us in this service, a time for us to once again affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This is always a special time in the service for me. It is a time when we, each one of us, can go to God in prayer. Let us take a moment now to open our hearts, and if there is something special that you would like to talk to God about, do it now. Holy and loving God, we come to you with hearts filled with gratitude, but also with pain and hurt. We are grateful to you for the many, many blessings you have showered on us. You have given us hope with the beginning of spring. The days are longer, the flowers are beginning to come up and bloom, the birds are returning. You have given us new hope. You have loved and supported us through this awful pandemic. You have given us the season of Lent to remind us once again of our need to examine our hearts to become better followers of Jesus. We are truly grateful for all you provide for us. Yet, dear Father, we are broken by sadness and loss. We have experienced so many deaths this past year. So many have died, not only from COVID, but also the many diseases and illnesses that are a part of our world. So many families and friends can no longer enjoy fellowship with those who have passed on. No matter what the cause, we ache because we miss the ones you have taken home. And we hurt with those who are suffering in any way. There are other parts of our lives that need your special touch as well, not only for those who have lost loved ones, but also for those who feel broken and shattered by the events of this past year. The loss of income, the social isolation, fear, anxiety, pain, anger, or other illness, all of these have been a part of our lives. Because of our feelings, we may have given up hope and rely more on our own wishes and desires, and ignore you. Bring us back to you in these final days of Lent. Restore our hope. Help us anticipate the retelling of the Easter story, Palm Sunday, Holy Week, and finally Easter Day itself, bringing new confidence in your promises to us. God of healing, God of grace, gently touch our lives with your refreshing spirit. Bring warmth and comfort, life and wholeness, restoration and renewal into our broken lives and souls. Renew us and refresh us through revived reliance on your Son, Jesus, the one who taught us how to pray. We call it our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We come to this time in our worship where we have an opportunity to give back to God through the sharing of our time, our talent, and our treasure. We are grateful for the generosity of all those who support God's ministry through supporting First Church. You are faithful givers, allowing the ministry of First Church to continue. Without you, we could not be a beacon of hope and comfort to our community and to the world. And we also must thank God, who has so richly blessed us. O God, accept and bless these gifts which we offer in response to the gracious gift of your life-giving Spirit to us. May these gifts and our lives be used to show your love and justice, mercy and peace, as they are revealed in and through Jesus, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Jesus invites us to believe in him and act on our belief.
He says, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in."
When you open your door, we rejoice as you experience him in your heart and look forward to eternal life.
He says, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father and I will make our abode with him."
Merciful God, we rejoice with you for all who are saved by belief and grace, and all who keep your word to love others as themselves. Amen.
As we go out this week, we have much to be joyful about. COVID is declining. We pray it will continue. Let us all recognize we have seen during the course of COVID much grief, much suffering, and many ways to experience that God is there for us even in these most trying times. So go forth with strength, strengthened faith, and willingness to help those most in need. Go in peace.